instrument goes back, you think about violin, change your blows, and singer's breathing, and same with wind instruments. And sometimes it's important for us also, since the piano pretty much the same sound, if you just go another, right? Well, with other instruments, even if they try to play the same, we need to pay attention to when we have a line that actually needs to go somewhere, that we listen to each tone that's making up that line as it gets either louder or it isn't even louder. There's always a direction to music, just like the way there is to everything, right? And I'll concentrate on those tiny little things, okay? The rest you're doing terrifically well. And maybe a couple of things with Tago, but we're very, very small. Look, we sometimes have to read things into the score and read enough about the composer and listen to other music he composed around the same period in order to gauge an idea about what both tempi, that marking of presto means to him at that time, and that marking of that first sforzando means to him. And sometimes we need to listen to other music around that time to kind of figure out where his head was at that time. Because for Beethoven and presto at this stage of his life and the presto later were not the same thing. Just like when you get older, your presto is going to be a lot different than it is right now. Believe me, I know, because my presto at your age was a lot different than it is at my age. So, with that said, my recommendation in this first sforzando, okay, is to go after this sort of surprise that he wants. You notice that there's no crescendo. It's almost like a light goes on. If played a little bit too loud or without voicing properly, it can sound not like a light going on, but it could sound perhaps like too many lights going on. And I'll tell you what we have to look forward to. Look at what happens later when he puts it with the juxtaposition of octaves. He makes the crescendo and he makes all the lights go on. So if we blow our cookies with that first sforzando, okay, later on it's not going to be that big a surprise. So my recommendation to you is keep us in suspense until that A. And just go. Don't go. Think about, before you play, hear that sound in your head. It's a concept, and I know it's difficult to realize, how can I hear a sound in my head? You can't. You can almost, especially talented people, untalented people can't do it. Talented people can do it, and you're talented. It's almost like you know where the sound is going to be. So if you throw your hands at the piano, this way, it's like you're saying, do whatever you want. If you hear the sound in your head, you know what that la is? La, just the way I'm pronouncing it. Final control of my tongue, la, right? Okay, try the same for me. No crescendo, good tempo, by the way. Give me a surprise on the la, but don't make it too loud. Okay? But know where the la is, and say to yourself, I'm going to plan to make all the lights go on here. Okay? And then we'll continue from there. Let's do that first. First of all, before you begin, have that whole first four measures in your head. How fast it's going to go so it doesn't change tempo here. Re, do, si, la, do, re, mi, fa. Conduct yourself inside. Feel it inside first, then play. Okay. You went this way. Did you feel control when you went this way? Did you say to yourself, how loud am I going to play? That's what you have to gauge yourself in. Because right now what you're getting is you're getting a loud sforzando, and it's sforzando. The problem is that for professionals, it sounds like a tiny bit out of control. I can speak to you in this terms because it's so much more fun working with talent. Because you understand this. You have to know where that la is. Play that la, just the la by itself, and just know where it is. As loud as you think it's going to go there. Just the la, just the A. To you is play it with the same point and with with that good voicing you do at the top, just don't perhaps strike it so quickly. More. When you get to the loud, just like, surprise, not surprise, surprise. Try it. Think first. You know what's so funny about it? It's basically what he's telling us. He lands on the big A at first, and he keeps almost ringing it. He finally gets it, so there's a root of the sonata. You understand? Try that one more time. Give it direction. You see that big phrase he has? Make it a long phrase. Hear each note, how it corresponds to that. Just a moment. Hear the direction? It isn't necessarily getting softer. We get softer because we run out of breath. If I sang it with my voice, re do si la si la so fa so fa mi re di re do re 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 di do re. Right? That's the way we would speak. Speak it with notes. We'll try. Find the direction. From right there. And then that way you close. And then you surprise everybody. Play the next part now. And the beautiful thing is we need to see his humor and we need to see his brilliance. What again do we have here? The A again. You know? It is not by chance. It is ordained by his genius. It's the way he puts it together. And we as performers have to see this equilibrium in what he writes, we have to see this architecture in what he writes, and perhaps a little bit of the brilliance in this guy, you know, and understand that if all the laws are the same whack, then of course none of them would be special, right? What makes them special, finally when you get to this one, because it's part of the forte, it actually sounds like bam, it's out of the water, right? So, one more time with this. When you have a passage that has many notes in it, and you have a big heavy bass note, the piano's gonna kick up on pedal. What you have to do is you have to wiggle your foot as you go. You cannot just play this way. It's almost impossible to teach. When you hear the piano going and kicking up on you, start just staying on top of the pedal and just wiggle it, okay? It's a way of letting sound escape from the piano and not having the sound cake up on you up and become a little bit too pedally. And you can keep the clarity of your right hand, which you already have. Try from there to get from here. You know what's going to happen? You know, when we first learned this trick, and it's a trick that we learned, we have to learn eventually because we play in different balls, small, big, bright, dull pianos, is that what starts happening when you start doing it is you feel like you're not coordinated. But as you go, what will happen is your ear will be the one that puts you together with this. So play it one more time and see if you notice if the piano starts going and you lose a little bit of clarity, or if it starts sounding a bit too overpedal. For right here, for right now. Okay, try again. Can you play pop pop? Just finish it without the whack. One more time. Yes. All you have to in a piece that took Beethoven perhaps 2 months to write, it's almost impossible to do. I would, it would be a great opportunity to be able to share this stuff with you and for you to continue. But you have such a wonderful teacher, I'm sure she's going to do it. But always remember that even though you play the piano, you have to consider breathing. You have to hear the sound inside of you. And just playing clean and fast and having a good technique does not mean all. You have to have the other stuff that perhaps we started to talk about. We're being so rudely but surely very talented. Okay? Terrifically talented. I wish you the very best of success. Do you listen to a lot of music?
Yeah, when you have a chance.
Do you listen to people play this piece?
Yeah.
Yeah? How many people have you heard play this piece?
I've seen a lot of live pictures and people.
How many? You know, here's some of the old guys way back when, even before me, old guy, and then recently, more recent old guys, and then somebody perhaps a little bit closer to your age. I think it's important to